Hello, and welcome to your Berks History, the Berks History Center's March 2019 program on BCTV. My name is Simon Bertolette. I'm the Executive Director of the Berks History Center and your host for this program. I'm joined on this program by Education Curator Vicki Hefner here at the Berks History Center, as well as we have a very special longtime friend of the Berks History Center, Hallie Vaughn, who's going to be talking to us tonight on Women's History Month. The Berks History Center Museum is open Tuesday through Friday from 10 a.m. to 3 p.m. and on Saturday from 9 a.m. to 3 p.m. Berks History Center Museum is located at 940 Center Avenue in the historic Center Park District at the corner of Spring Street and Center Avenue. The Berks History Center Research Library is located directly behind the Berks History Center at 160 Spring Street, the corner of Spring Street and 2nd Street. The Berks History Center Research Library is open Wednesday through Friday from 8 a.m. to 5 p.m. and on Saturday from 8 a.m. to 4 p.m.
Become a member of the Berks History Center. Individual memberships start at $55, family at $65, but become a Gold Card member or contributing member at $100, and you will receive admission to all Second Saturday programs. As a membership, you will get a family level, you get a voucher to one of our Second Saturday programs, and they have become very popular. We've been having great attendance over the last year or so with our Second Saturday program, so that is a true benefit to your membership. So please do consider becoming a contributing member. Additionally, you will receive 4 historical reviews. And if you know Charlie Adams, our editor, he does a great job and there's always interesting articles in our review. You would also receive free admission to our museum and library and 10% off in our museum store. So please, if you're not a member already, become a member of the Berks History Center.
Thanks, Vicki. And while we're on the subject of memberships and support of that kind, I encourage all of you watching to support BCTV. If you like watching programs such as Your Berks History and the Berks History Center or other programs, I encourage you to support BCTV. All gifts, no matter what the size, are appreciated and necessary. You can send your support by writing a check to BCTV and mailing it to 1900 North 13th Street, Reading, Pennsylvania, 19604. Please help support BCTV. It's a wonderful organization.
Later in the program, we're going to hear from Hallie Vaughn, who is our Second Saturday program for March. I would like to tell you, though, about our upcoming Berks History Conference that is on April the 13th. This is our 4th annual conference, and we do like to theme our conferences, so this year will be presentations on Berks County and the Civil War. We have 4 gentlemen joining us for the day. Mark Flum is a good friend to the Berks History Center, and he will be talking about his love of the First Defenders, which was the regiment from Berks County that signed up first in the Civil War. John Lawler will also be making a presentation, All Manner of Petty Annoyances, Executing Federal Civil War Drafts in the Berks County. And then also Stephen Recker, I'm particularly interested in this gentleman. What he's done is taken images from the Battle of Antietam and then taken images of today of what those different areas look like. So he will have 200 supporting images, and the title of his program is Rare Images of Antietam and the Photographers Who Took Them. And Scott Mingus then will be returning in the afternoon. Scott Mingus has been visiting the Berks History Center every spring for about 3 or 4 years. And his program will be Philadelphia, Wilmington, and Baltimore Railroad and the First Defenders. So to register for this, you can call the Berks History Center or go on our website. It is $60 for non-members, $50 for members, and it does include a box lunch. And we're hoping to see you at our Berks History Conference again on April the 13th. Upcoming bus trips, I'm very excited about the bus trip I put together on Tuesday, April the 2nd. We will be visiting Winterthur and having a house tour, but we'll also be visiting the new exhibit they'll have opening just that weekend on the fashions of Crown. So if you're a fan of the Crown, you definitely want to see it. My bus trip, I have only a few seats left, so you need to call if you're interested and reserve your seat, because I'm now below 10 seats for the bus trip. So that's wonderful news. Another day trip that we'll be doing is Charlie Adams, DC and Catacombs on June the 1st. If you're interested in that, please do call. My next multi-day trip is the Hot Air Balloon Festival in historic Vermont. And those dates are June 13th through the 16th. We'll be going to a number of different places in Vermont and then also enjoying the Hot Air Balloon Festival high in the Keechee Mountains. So I'm really excited about that trip. The cost is $675 double occupancy and $800 for single occupancy. And that trip's a go. I have enough people signed up that I know it's gonna run. So I hope to see you on one of my next bus trips.
That's great. And before we get off the subject, I also want to recognize for the Berks History Conference the generous support of Berks Packing for providing all the ring bologna, the sausage, the cheeses, as well as the box lunch, and also Sweet Street desserts. They have generously supplied the desserts for that day. So big shout out to Berks Packing and Sweet Streets for all they've done for the History Center and the Berks History Conference.
I'm here with a good friend, Hallie Vaughn, who's been a volunteer at the Berks History Center as a docent for about 15 years. She's a retired third grade school teacher from Muhlenberg Elementary, and she also has had for a long time an interest in women's history. And for a number of years now, she has been presenting at our second Saturday program in March as part of Women's History Month. She will be back again on Saturday, March the 9th, with a new topic that she's been researching this last year, and it's on the Code Girls of World War II.
Correct. The Code Girls is a book written by Liza Mundy, and like you said, these were the code breakers of World War II. And the attack on Pearl Harbor started a whole series of events. People were questioning how the United States could have let that happen. And our intelligence was very poor at that time. We had no spies or anyone in Europe. And so the Navy began in earnest to do something about that. So the Navy began to send letters to the Seven Sisters Colleges, Bryn Mawr, Wellesley, all the ones in the Northeast, to the best students, and these secret letters began going out. And the girls would receive them, and they would be asked by one of their professors to meet them at a time and location, and they would be asked two questions. Can you think what those questions might have been?
No.
Well, the first one was, do you like crossword puzzles? Mm. And the second one was, are you engaged to be married?
That's an odd
one. And so they were introducing this new career called cryptanalysis, which no one knew what exactly that was. But they were looking at all the best students from these Seven Sisters Colleges. That was the Navy. Meanwhile, the Army also had to beef up their code-breaking business, and so they decided to recruit from teaching colleges across the United States, and also any teachers who were currently doing their teaching, but who were wanted to change careers. And so they were sending handsome officers out to post offices in small towns across the United States. They had advertisements of what you could do to help. They were asked also those two questions, and they were looking for women who wanted to serve the war effort in Washington, and women, and this is a quote, who could keep their lips zipped. So these women were told that just because they were female, that didn't mean that they would not be shot if they told anybody what kind of work they were doing. They were told if you were asked what you were what your job was, you were to say you were emptying trash cans and sharpening pencils. So these women in the Army and the Navy were the backbone of one of the most successful intelligence efforts in history. It was an effort that began before Pearl Harbor began and went on even after Pearl Harbor ended.
How many women did they recruit?
I think altogether there were 10,000.
I did some research yesterday on the author's website, and it was over 10,000.
Yes.
And it did say also the women, there were some interviews that you can watch that they weren't even to talk to each other.
Exactly. Liza Mundy went through the archives for a long time, for decades, in getting this together, and she was actually able to do interviews with 20 code-breaking survivors.
That's really neat.
So at the heart of her book is a young woman named Dot Braden, who was 23, and her mother was a single parent. She was teaching school at a place, Chatham, Virginia, in Chatham High School. And her first job there was, she said, chaotic, because at the time, there were no men left after Pearl Harbor. All the male teachers went into the Army or the Navy, and it left the high schools in really a mess. So she began teaching, and before she knew it, she was in charge of teaching almost every subject there was, including a calisthenics program that the government implemented to help young people move around more. Mm-hmm. She said, and all it amounted to was her marching those senior girls back and forth from lunch, and they got to calling her General Braden. She said the straw that broke the camel's back, though, was her roommate she had been boarding with decided to marry her fiance, who was going to fight in the war, and she up and left, and Dot had no way of affording the rent by herself, and then she inherited this teacher's composition classes, so she was just doing almost everything. And when the final bell rang, she packed up her clothing and went home to Lynchburg, Virginia, and told her mother she was never going back to teaching again, that it would kill her. So her mother later on told her that there at the Virginia Hotel, there was a man there who was looking for former teachers, and her mother made it sound kind of mysterious. So Dot went down, they took her references, they were very interested in her languages because she had done well at languages at school, and they told her something about cryptanalysis, which she had no idea what it was, but she allowed herself to hope. And in a few weeks' time, she got a letter to be one of the cryptographers in Washington, D.C. She had never been out of Virginia, so she went to Washington and began her career in the cryptanalysis part. It was associated with the Army Signal Corps. And she caught on very quickly and soon found that she would be part of one of the most important cryptography units there was, and this was dealing with the information that was going between the Japanese Army and its shipping industry. So that was how Dot Braden got involved. But the Navy and the Army both had their two separate code-breaking units, and they didn't really get along. They didn't really talk much. They were kind of in competition with one another. And so the book tells a lot about their interaction or lack of interaction. And Dots didn't even share her information with her roommate, who was also a code breaker, but working in a different mm-hmm. unit at Washington.
I'm sure in the book there's some examples of like the codes they were breaking.
Yes.
And it looks very complicated.
It looked very complicated to me. I kept reading mm-hmm. it over and over again, trying to figure out what they were mm-hmm. talking about. And it was very, very complicated, involved. They had to encipher and decipher, and they had numbers, and then as soon as they would feel like they were getting used to some of the Japanese codes, the Japanese would change mm-hmm. their codes and they would start again at square one. So it tells a lot about what all these gals went through. They worked 24-hour shifts. They would work 8-hour shifts. They would go the entire day, and just the different machines they had to work on and the different codes they were trying to break, it was just phenomenal. And then, of course, besides the Japanese, there were the German codes. One was called the Enigma, and it was just very, very detailed. And they found that teachers made good code breakers because they were used to low pay. They were intelligent and used to discerning details in things. And so teachers made excellent code breakers.
And you said it was just recruitments from the East Coast because of the seven colleges?
Well, that was the Navy's, okay. Yes.
They, and then the Army recruited
from
across
all
the
over.
United States?
Yeah. Yeah,
how exciting if you were from the West Coast to be able to go to D.C.
Many of those women had never been mm-hmm. out of the Midwest or come to Washington. And she describes it in her book, when Dot Braden got to Washington, it was just packed with people, all kinds, men, women, blacks, whites. Everybody was just in Washington, and it was very, very hectic. Mm-hmm. Because they had to get ready before they were really prepared to get ready.
Were there any surprises in the book for you? Like, you weren't surprised they were asked if they were engaged or not. That didn't surprise
you.
Well,
back then, it said in the book, I think I'm right, 3/4 of America's teachers had to quit, the females had to quit when they got married. That was one of the reasons. And they were unencumbered by children mm-hmm. because they were female teachers mm-hmm. for the most part. So, that wasn't too surprising. I found out they did have a African-American code-breaking group. And they had their own unit that was in charge of looking into the banks and their financial dealings with Japan and with Germany. And not much was known about that. I mean, that wasn't very well known in the book.
Well, thank you very much, Hallie, for being here today. Again, the program is scheduled for March the 9th. We have had record attendance at recent programs. In fact, our February 2nd Saturday program, we had 190 people attend, and it was really standing room only. So I encourage you to come early. We open at 9, refreshments start at 9:30, and then we don't want to reveal all the secrets of this program. So I'm going to thank Hallie for coming on our BCTV program today, and I hope to see you next Saturday. I am back again with Hallie Vaughn. Another one of Hallie's and my projects is with the Berks County Commission for Women, which disbanded after their 20th anniversary a few years ago. I was introduced to the group by a longtime volunteer, Barbara Goda, who unfortunately passed away a few years ago. But Hallie did not want the 100th anniversary of women gaining the right to vote to pass without some sort of celebration, commemoration. So starting about 6 months ago, women from the commission got together a core group, and we formed the Women's History Alliance, which is not just Berks County Commission women, it's 20 or more women's groups throughout Berks County that are coming together. We've had our first meeting, and we'll be meeting again on February the 27th, which I know will be after this program airs. But we're putting together a celebration starting next March 2020 that will run through August the 26th, which is National Equality Day.
Equality Day.
National Women's Equality Day, and that'll be a celebration at the Doubletree on Wednesday, August the 26th. But Hallie, why don't you talk a little bit about the suffrage movement and how exceptional those women were?
Okay, well, of course, the women's suffrage movement started in 1848 at Seneca Falls, New York. And these women were very, very adamant about women gaining the right to vote. And over the years, they kept trying, and it seemed with not a whole lot of promise. In 1920, women finally gained the right to vote. They had to, of course, they went into coal mines, they went into industries, and they had to ask men to come into their corner with them and show that they wanted women to get the right to vote. And so finally, in 2020, after many of the original suffragists had passed away, women gained the right to vote. And like Vicki said, we didn't want 2020 to come around and to look at one another and say, we should have done something. Mm-hmm. So if you are in any kind of a women's group that would like to get involved, we are open for anybody and everyone to share their ideas with us and become part of the event, which, like Vicki said, will go from March next year almost to the end mm-hmm. of the year with different events. So feel free to join us and become part of this celebration, where we hope to involve as many Berks County people and Reading people as we can.
I think the most exciting thing for our group is numerous people are researching, and we think that we're the first in Pennsylvania to put together a celebration. There are other states. Virginia, for example, started about 10 years ago raising money for a statue, mm-hmm. which is wonderful. But we think we are the first group in Pennsylvania, so it's exciting that Berks County is at the top mm-hmm. of it, and it'll be a great celebration.
Yes, and we, when we started this, we didn't really have anything in mind to do except for the for second mm-hmm. Saturday and the dinner on August 26th. So we're open to all ideas and events that you or your group would like to include in our celebration.
And please do visit. We have a website that's just opening, and it's Suffrage Berks 2020 Centennial. So if you do just a little bit of research, it should be up and running by early March, so by the time this program airs. And we're very excited about it. We had close to 40 people at our first meeting, which was the end of January, and we're hopeful for tomorrow night gaining some new faces and getting a schedule together with different events and different organizations and just pull it all together so that we have several months of acknowledging the work that the women did and the work that really is to be done yet.
Yes.
Thank you, Hallie.
You're welcome.
I'd like to thank education curator Vicki Hefner and longtime friend Hallie Vaughn for joining me on the program today. I'd also like to thank you for watching. And if you're interested in finding out more about the wonderful programs, events, and exhibits that we have going on here at the Berks History Center, I urge you to visit our website, www.berkshistory.org, or at Berks History on Instagram, Facebook, and Twitter. Thanks so much for being with us. You can follow us on those websites I mentioned, as well as on our website. And we look forward to seeing you again for the April 2019 Your Berks History program on BCTV. Thanks, and see you next month.